The oh, thank you. greetings, Black family. Welcome to the Education Masterclass brought to you by Ebu Cosini Solutions. We trust that all of you are going to enjoy this journey with us. We are in season four of this amazing initiative by Ebu Cosini Solutions, which is going to bring us nutritional packaged packaged nutrition to empower our spirits, to empower our souls, to empower our minds as the Black family. So we just want to just establish that everybody is here. I can see that our speakers are here for today. And therefore, I think we should start, given that it is our time to start now. Let me just maybe get an indication from our brother Difference if we are ready to start.
Let's give it another 3 minutes.
Okay, great. So we'll start in about 3 minutes' time. Thank you very much.
So who are we today? We are the morning after, the makeshift youth, the slave ship captured. Our diaspora is the final chapter, the ancestral lineage built pyramids, America's first immigrant, the king's son and daughters from our waters, the first architect, the first philosophers, astronomers, the first prophets and the doctors was us.
Hey, now can we all pray, each in his own way, teaching and learning. We can work it out. We love a warm bed. We love some warm bread and shelter from the storm dread. And we can work it out. Mother Nature feeds all in famine and drought. Tell those selfish in ways not to share us out. What's a tree without root? Lion without tooth? The lie without truth? You hear me out. Africa must wake up. You sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, may a better day come. They start we working. Can you tell me, young ones, who are we today? Yeah, Lord. Well, Africa must wake up. You sleeping sons of Jacob. For what tomorrow may bring, make some more love come. Yesterday we working. I tell you, young blood, this world is yours today.
Thank you, Black family, and welcome to season four of the Black Education Masterclass, brought to you by Ebu Cosini Solutions. As many of you might know, Ebu Cosini Solutions is an initiative that has been established many years ago and has been working with young people across Azania, and also have been, you know, inspiring Black people to share ideas across the boundaries of the continent, and even across the boundaries that divide the Black community across the world. And today we are gathering, true to the nature of this masterclass, to nudge Black people back to our own essence and to understand the Black condition and the positionality of Black people across the world, whether it is social, whether it is political, whether it is spiritual or even economic. And the Black Education Masterclass helps us to understand that Black condition, and also further to you know, help us with ideas of how to properly diagnose, but also how to come up with a prognosis for the Black condition. The facility that we will be using today to navigate the Black condition is the arts. And we have two exciting speakers today who are going to guide us through two topics on how the arts can play a role in really understanding and unpacking the Black condition, and looking at how we can use the arts as a navigational tool back to our essence of being as Black people. And I'm going to start introducing our first speaker, which is Mwalumu Wema Rahopala. She is an Azanian, but based also in the USA, a creative practitioner who is a director, an artist, and an education justice advocate. She's an adherent of the transformative power of the arts as a catalyst for social change. And Mwalumu Mwema is also the founder of Bridges, which is a Pan-Africanist arts movement that facilitates opportunities for creatives globally. Mwalumu is going to talk to us shortly, but I just also wanted to maybe just introduce myself. My name is Vuyisile Mshudulu, in case you haven't seen it on the screen, and I am part of the Mutapa Afrocentric Dialogues, which is a platform that I've co-founded along with Sompisi Godite Mpemba, as many of you would know him, which is Velimbele ka Sompisi. And to start off this masterclass, we are going to take Mwalumu Wema first, but then later on, we are also going to take Mwalumu Saila Babaluku, who I'm going to introduce at that time. But I would like to welcome all of you as our audience, and to also welcome the two speakers who are going to guide us. To start off the masterclass, we invite our sister Wema Rahopala, who's going to talk on the role of the arts in African empowerment. And we hand over to her at this point in time. Over to you, Mwalumu Wema Rahopala.
Greetings, greetings, Dumela. Thank you so much, family. Wow. Thank you for that beautiful introduction. And I'm grateful to be here right now on the other side of the world, actually in Alaska. It is 9 a.m. on this side, now 10 hours behind South Africa. I'm usually 6 hours behind when I'm in New York on the East Coast, but I was happy to wake up early to be a part of this beautiful session. We are about to talk about something that I love talking about, and that is the arts and African empowerment, my favorite subject. I have so much to say and very little time, so I am going to jump right in. I'm going to share my screen now so that we can kind of see what the essence of this time together will actually look like. And let's start us off from the beginning, right? This session today is called Soul of Uhuru, the Arts and the Movement Toward African Liberation, the Role of the Arts in African Empowerment. Again, I'm so grateful to just have the time and space to join you today. The agenda today that we're going to go through is actually looks like this. we'll do a soul centering and grounding, because we're in all parts of the globe today, so we need to bring ourselves together in this work. And it's also going to support you in your learning how we can use these tools to garner creativity and bring in new connections in the arts and how we can move towards African liberation. We'll do some brief introductions to African liberation movements and how they have influenced the arts. Just a bit, just a tidbit, some of the things that really have inspired me. And then we're going to go into a little bit of a personal journey from Roots, Rhythm, and Revolution to a newer piece called Listen. Followed by a moment of inquiry and questions, and of course, some time for a Q&A. I had some additional things prepared for you with visual arts, but we don't have the time. So I said, in the love of visual arts as well, I have two amazing visual artists on this slide here. One is Aaron Douglas, and the other is Wagin Chimutu, a Kenyan artist and an American artist, is Aaron Douglas in the Black Power Movement. And so we can see that first image of breaking the chains and this image here that moves into Afrofuturism and new ways of being. And this piece right here was a phenomenal sculpture that I actually was able to touch and experience myself. So we're going to go into our soul centering work first. So I want folks to get themselves grounded, get ready, because we're going to use the work of Sweet Honey and the Rock, I'm Going to Stand, to center and focus how we're moving towards through this day today. And artists have long stood up and spoken out against systemic injustices, you know, that we exist in. Mama Nina Simone said that the duty of the artist is to reflect the times, right? But not only that, the duty of the artist is to think about how we transform these times that we exist in, how we wield this creativity powerhouse so that we can create a world we can thrive in. And in this moment of centering and grounding, I want you to think about what makes you get up and say, now is the time. What are you standing for? All right. Let's go right into it. You're going to listen to a little bit of music for about a minute. And I actually want you to do this work. So I'm taking the moment to give you a chance to center yourself and get ready. And we're going to listen to I'm Going to Stand for about a minute and a half. And I want you to think about what you're standing for.
If we can just maybe consider the sound, Mwalimo, because we are not getting any audio at the moment.
Okay.
Not obey injustice. We will not obey exploitation. I'm gonna stand injustice. We will not bow down to exploitation. What you gonna do? I'm gonna stand. I'm gonna stand. I'm gonna stand. I'm gonna stand.
I'm gonna stand.
I just can't tolerate racism. I just can't tolerate
injustice.
I just won't tolerate exploitation. What you gonna do? I'm gonna stand. I'm gonna stand. I'm gonna stand. I'm gonna stand.
I'm gonna stand. I'm gonna stand.
Okay, we are back. I apologize for the difficulty in hearing the sound for that moment, but I do hope when you heard the few seconds that I played that you were able to help to ground yourself in things that you would stand for. You can drop that in the chat, things that you stand for right now, or you can just think about it internally as well. I'm going to go back to our main screen and the work that we're doing right now so that we can move forward. But thank you for being here with us in this journey. All right. So my work comes from you, Bridges, a Pan-African arts movement. You saw my logo in the beginning. But I've been influenced by so many amazing Africans throughout the diaspora and the continent that have informed the work that I do now. Everyone able to see the screen as well?
Yes, we can see. We're following. Thank you.
Great, great. Just making sure. And I mean all of the arts, and we don't have the time to go through each one in detail, but we're going to take a close look at literary arts and poetry, dance and music, and a little bit of theater and film. Yes, we will do it all. I'm going to start us off with looking at Maya Angelou. And yesterday, today, and tomorrow, Africans have used the arts to amplify our movements towards liberation. And we're going to look at this work that Dr. Maya Angelou said. Now, if you can, take note, because power thoughts, these quotes, can help to guide us through the works that we do every day. And Maya Angelou said, history, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived, but must be faced with courage and need not to be lived again. We may encounter defeats, but we must not be defeated. And it seems to me when looking at her life, not only was she a poet, and a creative writer. She was also a dancer and a singer in her younger days. And one thing that she's very, very known for, when she was very young, she experienced sexual assault and she became mute. And she didn't speak for a very, very, very long time. But when she spoke, her words, her thoughts, her visions spoke volumes. And not only did she influence, you know, amazing artists, but even it feels like she was an answer to some of the work that other artists are doing today. I'm going to give you a small excerpt from Dr. Maya Angelou's Still I Rise. And one current poet who is one of the youngest poets right now making waves, and her work is called The Hill We Climb by Amanda Gorman. I'm going to show you how we have answered our call by continuing to pass the baton through the arts. So this first work is Still I Rise. Out of the huts of history shame, I rise. Up from a past that's rooted in pain, I rise. I'm a black ocean, leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave. I am the dream and the hope of the slave. And then Amanda Gorman answers this piece in her 2021 inauguration poem. And I'll give you a small excerpt of that as well. We will rise from the sun-baked south. We will rebuild, reconcile, and recover. And every nook of our nation and every corner of our country, our people, diverse and beautiful, will emerge battered and beautiful. And when the day comes, we step out of the shade, aflamed and unafraid. A new dawn blooms as we free it. For there is always light if we are brave enough to see it, if we are brave enough to be it. Now, these poets, it feels like Amanda Gorman like literally picked up the baton and kept running. And that's what we must do. We must recognize and elevate the legacy of our ancestors, the legacy that they left, but continue to build and shape a future that we can thrive in. My background is in theater and dance, and touching on just a few of the powerful influences of African liberation, I'm going to talk about works that really inspire. But first, let's talk about the word Uhuru. Uhuru means freedom, right? And as I'm saying in this work, it is the soul of our freedom, is the art. And one phenomenal artist that exemplifies that is Dr. Pearl Primus. Even in this shot of her jumping, her dance was profound. The very essence of freedom. And she says, I dance not to entertain, but to help people understand each other. Because through dance, I've experienced the wordless joy of freedom. And I seek it more now, fully, for my people and for people everywhere. And Pearl Primus was born in Trinidad and was studied anthropology and studied dance and came to Africa and studied the roots of dance through Africa and also exemplified that through the Americas. But she did not shy away from talking about issues that we were facing. She created a dance called Strange Fruit, similar to Billie Holiday. And she also was inspired by Langston Hughes and created a choreographic piece called The Negro Speaks of Rivers. She even choreographed a piece about the burnings of the bombings in Birmingham, Alabama in the 1950s. So throughout time, we look at what's going on and we use the arts to exemplify what we're feeling inside, and we grow from that and we grow to change the work that we have, the world that we have around us. Before I get into like roots, rhythm, and revolution, and the work that brought me to South Africa in 2012, 2013, I have to say that theater and film and music have huge impacts on how we engage and interact in the world. There was a film called Amantla, A Revolution in Four-Part Harmony, and it exemplified, it amplified freedom songs in apartheid era, the toy toy dances and the protest music was so instrumental in its influence on me, as well as all the folks throughout. So it's important for us to show our work, to share our work, to grow from it, because it helps to grow and teach us all. What's interesting about Mandla, when I started doing even more research around it, of course, the response is away to, right? Power to the people, the power is ours. But that work was also, those words were also informed by the Black Power movement, which said all power to the people from the Black Panthers. And so we see how we continue to create bridges and influence and inform and engage with each other in numerous ways. This work, Roots, Rhythm, and Revolution, was my answer to that through theater and dance. And I brought it here to South Africa in 2013 and also did workshops on arts and activism with the Bukusini Solutions, as well as this phenomenal, phenomenal poet, Vangile Gancho, where we looked at how we can re-envision revolution through Asada Shakur's work, re-envisioning revolution, which was phenomenal. So since then, we also have ways to understand that collaboration through the arts is one of the answers for us to grow and expand our understanding of the revolution and liberation movements. This work, Fear Paralyzes, Courage Mobilizes, is the carrying call for us to not sit down, but to stand up and to move. We will only have a few minutes, but I do want to share with you a short excerpt from a collaboration piece that we did through Bridges of Pan-African Arts Movement called Listen. It's an Afrofuturist collaboration performance piece fusing poetry, instrumentals, music, and vocals. This work embodies ancestral memory, propelling momentum of a shape-shifting world only we can create, challenging the audience to envision a world of possibilities outside of the current torture cycle of racism, which is embedded in the fabric of America. You'll hear myself on spoken word and poetry, my husband Pitsira Rahopala on vocals and percussion, and our son Malcolm Melendez on bass. And not written here, but in utero, was pregnant with our daughter Maya in Shaha. So I will share with you just a few minutes of listen. Hopefully my skills in screen sharing with this next work will work a little bit better than the first. Okay. Please let me know if you do not hear the sound when I play it.
Listen. ancestors, speak to us. Through the blood coursing through our veins, telling us to remember.
Remember.
Listen.
Listen.
Learn. Build and build and build and build, build on innovative ancestral legacies. These shores, they witnessed torture and rape of human beings brought against their will, stolen from our mothers, fathers, sisters, aunties, uncles, grandparents who hold libraries of wisdom, told to
forget.
Generations told to
forget.
For survival.
So we got a chance to see just a bit of that work. I have a resource paper for you that you'll receive by email with some of the references that I've had throughout this work, including the full piece. So if you do want to see the full work, please don't worry. I will send that to you. It's about a 10-minute piece. So you can watch it at your own time. All right. You can see a bit of what happens when artists collaborate, when we bring together creative works, when we think about the issues that are going on currently and we respond to them. And that work can speak volumes. We only have a few minutes, but I did want to take a moment to think about questions of inquiry, because we can't further our learning unless we do the work, unless we do the work internally to think about answer these questions. And I just gave three questions for us. Where are we going? Where are we going? Yes, it's a big question. How does the arts frame our vision? And what do we use to shape, create, embody, inform, and embrace the Africa we want to see? These are big questions. And I actually wanted to take maybe 2 minutes for us to just think about those questions and use a little bit of balance with music, not yet Uhuru, by later Mbulu, to listen to ourselves for just a little bit, and then we'll go into our Q&A time. Before we do that, I just want to thank you for this time together and listening to some of the work that I presented here. But first, I want you to take the moment and listen closely to each of these questions. Where is it taking you? Where do you want to go? How does the arts frame our vision? And what do we use to shape, create, embody, and inform and embrace the Africa we want to see? As you think about that, I'm going to start us off a little bit. And I think that we are going into a space where we are challenged to not sit down anymore, to always get up, to always speak to our children, to always inform them about how we need to move forward and listen closely to ways that they're thinking about moving forward. The other day, a few weeks ago, we did a children's piece called Kitty Corner with Bridges, a Pan-African Arts Movement. And there was a segment called Liberation, where we just helped the young people to understand where their liberation power actually was. And now my daughter at 2 is singing that liberation song daily. And she thinks about where her liberation power is. And so I want to leave that with you to think about where your liberation power actually is. Where are you feeding your liberation? Don't stop. Keep going. And look to other artists and other friends and community to build on that. It's not up to you to hold it all, but it's up to us to hold it with each other and to grow and inform through collaboration and vision. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mwalumu Wema, for a great and inspiring message. And I also just wanted to deposit one name when you mentioned the Amandla Cultural Ensemble, which was directed by the late Ubaba Jonas Kwangwa. There's a name that came to mind that I wrote about recently, and that is the name of Vuyisile Mini. There are many people who don't know Vuyisile Mini, but he was one of the leading composers of liberation songs in South Africa. And he was born on the 8th of April in 1920. And at the age of 44, in 1964, I think it was on the 6th of November, along with two of his comrades, Zinakile Mgaba, who was 35, and Wilson Kainga, who was 38, they were sentenced to death and executed by hanging by the apartheid regime. So this demonstrates two things: that our oppressor understands the mobilizing power of the arts, but secondly, that there are many other creatives who were willing to pay the ultimate price for our freedom. And I want us today, as we reflect on your presentation, to remember the name of Vuyisile Mini. Black family, if you have any questions, now is an opportunity to do so. You may raise your hand or drop a comment in the chat box, and we will take your questions. But we would also like you to reflect on these questions that are posted on the screen, and we'll give about 2 or 3 minutes for that. If there are any questions, then we will take such. If not, then we will move to our next presentation. So if you have a question, please just raise your hand and we will recognize you. Okay, I see, Mokheto, I don't know if you have your hand up, and I also see Brother Difference. Let's take you, Brother Difference.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mwalimu, for that beautiful presentation and all the work that you shared with us. Mine is a quick question around inspiration for the arts. I think my biggest concern when I look at the current state of the arts is we are not necessarily using the arts to continue with the liberation struggle anymore. And I'm just, you know, by mere observation and seeing arts being used purely just for entertainment and does not necessarily convey a message that relates to the challenges that we are facing today. And I know some of it is through certain agendas. You know, there's certain artists that share certain messages that we can relate to, and then they get signed by record labels, and all of a sudden their message changes and things like that. What is your advice to young people that are in the arts for finding inspiration in our current struggles? Because I feel like that is being neglected, and I'm talking about it in like all the different forms of arts, be it in music, in drama, and all these different fields. Just your advice as to how can we find inspiration in the challenges that we continue to face today, and convey those messages through the arts.
Thank you so much, Brother Difference. I appreciate that question.
Before you respond, Sister Nema, I think let's take the question from Brother Nzanwa, that last question, then you can answer both questions at the same time, and then we can move to the next presentation from there.
Sure.
Brother Nzanwa, over to you.
Thank you, and greetings to the family. Thank you to the Mwalimu for the great presentation. So my question, it's actually, I'm actually glad because you, the moderator, actually, you've kind of answered already, but I'm gonna ask it anyway so that I can hear from the Mwalimu what she has to say. So basically, I just want to know, what do you think, what do you say to people who hold the views that us, you know, as a people, as Black people, things like art, it actually falls under a luxury, you know, that we can't really afford. Okay, so just to give like a context to these views, like this view is coming from the fact that as Black people, we've contributed a lot. If you just look at, you know, like it can be music, you can even go to sports, anything like that, we've contributed a lot, but at the end of the day, it did not really help us. Or if I can say that we are still in this position as being like the bottom, you know. So those people also think that we do have priorities, and most of them think our current priorities are finance and defense. You know, and they think that if we take our time to, you know, do things like, you know, art and anything else, it's actually like a luxury that we can't really afford. So basically, yeah, that's kind of my question. What do you say to the people who hold that view? That's basically my question.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you for both of these questions. And I think that they're very, very timely. In this moment, first and foremost, I actually want to actually comment on whether or not artists are still creating work that is a reflection of the issues that we actually go through. Artists are always creating and are always creating works that are actually defining our experiences. During the time where we were dealing with Black Lives Matter, so many artists stood up and stood out and created new works that reflected exactly what was going on in the streets. And that's why the world knows about it. It doesn't know about it because of just the protest, but because of the music and the art and the visual arts that came out of that moment. People see the Black power fist in a different way than they used to see it. And in not just in a moment of the civil rights movement, in the moment of what exists right now, in our connection through Pan-African liberation. And it's because of artists that we are able to think about that and grow from that. In fact, my son even mentioned that when George Floyd was murdered by police officers at, what were you, like 15? He's on this call right now. I don't remember. 15 years old, I think. He said he had to make some music that really, yes, thank you, Malcolm. He had to make some music to really reflect on that moment, that struggle, that time, because it meant so much to him as well as other young people. So I definitely have to defer and say, maybe we're not privy to seeing all the work that's coming out because of media's influence in showing only the things, the cute little cat videos or whatever videos that are most popular and viral right now. Those are put in the forefront of our media attention when the work of the artists that are actually reflecting on this time need to be put to the forefront. So we need to seek out those works. We need to share them. We need to pay for them. We need to amplify them. We need to continue to encourage artists to be creative in that way. And then the final question around poetry is that, sorry, art, is it a luxury? Reminded me immediately of Audre Lorde. And Audre Lorde wrote a piece called Poetry is Not a Luxury. I will advise everyone in there and their mothers and their fathers and their sisters and their grandparents to read this work because it is the truth. Poetry is not a luxury. Art is not a luxury. We do it because we have to do it, because without it, we are unable to truly see how we can move forward. The reason why I call this work The Soul of Uhuru is because I truly believe that art is the soul of freedom. This is the space that we are most free in. Think about Redemption Song. Just think about a few things that everyone knows because of the work that the artist put in. Emancipate yourself from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Like, let's think about works that have touched us and continue to share and grow in that work. Thank you for those great questions, by the way. I love them. And please feel free to continue to reach out and stay in touch. My details are here, and I also will send you a PDF version of this whole sharing that I gave to you, including links, so that you can further your growth and understanding and how art is influencing change. Thank you.
Thank you, Mwalimo. But I also want to just add, before we introduce our next speaker, that we, as the, you know, Black community, particularly those of us that describe ourselves as conscious, we really need to not rely on the popular media for our artistic content, because there is so much artistic content that is conscious. To the Black struggles that is currently available. And I'm just going to mention a few. Theater production by Monaghan Motsabi, who's one of the authors whose all his works speak directly to the heart of the Black condition. Then you have a production that was recently performing at the Market Theater, Kongolose Commanding Commissars by J. Bob Chabalala, also a piercing, you know, a analysis of contemporary South African politics, and also really going to the heart of post-colonial African states and characterizing them beautifully. Then there was recently a musical production that reflected on the contribution of music to the struggle by Billy Monama. It was titled My Way Africa, performed a few weeks back at the Market Theater as well. Then there was also a production which was in many ways also a dedication to Inkosi Jomo Msobo Mvuma Koma, who was one of the warriors that fought against the British in the transfrontier wars in the Eastern Cape. It is titled Exit Exist, and it will be performing in Cape Town at the Baxter Theatre in October. Then you have got groups like Ipupo Likabiko, you've got a poet like Makafula Vilakazi. The list is endless. And I think we really need to try and inform ourselves about what is existing so that we don't just rely on the popular media for our content. And I think that, you know, this is a perfect opportunity to introduce Mwalimo Saila Babaluku, who is the founder of Back to the Source. And it's really a collective of East African builders whose vision is to grow indigenous hip hop. And we know that, you know, hip hop music, in fact, hip hop is not just music, it is a culture. And it's celebrating 50 years this year since its inception in 1973 in the Bronx, in the Bronx in New York. It's celebrating 50 years globally, but in South Africa, it is celebrating 40 years since the introduction of the culture in South Africa. And there is a piece that I'm currently working on about hip hop and its evolution. And I'm just going to read an extract from that as part of my introduction of our next speaker. Is that hip hop has, from its inception, been openly rebellious, uncompromisingly disruptive, and unapologetically nonconformist to the popular culture. It has, decided to position itself as a culture on it, in its own right, and permeated spaces and imaginations across the world. Hip hop has always been conscientizing through profound lyricism, inspiring through artistic depth, and affirming through its pro-Black stance. And I think this is really a great moment to have Mwalimu Saila Babaluku, who's going to, you know, try and connect, reconnect us to our essence and tell us about the impact of hip hop in, taking us back to authentic ancestral transformative powers to heal, to restore, and to unify the Black population, and also to impact Black lives across the globe, in the continent, and even in the diaspora. And the subject that Mwalimu is going to speak on is the practice of hip hop and give an indigenous perspective to that. Welcome, Mwalimu, and we trust that you are going to enlighten us and true to the celebration of 50 years of hip hop since DJ Kool Herc, you know, defying the disco, popular disco music at the time to create a culture that has now lived on for 50 years and is proving that it's going to live on for many more centuries to come. Over to you, Mwalimu.
Blessings. Let me try to share my screen right quick. Can we see my screen clearly?
Yes, we can see it clearly. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Greetings, relatives, from all across the parts of the universe where you're tuning in from. I'm happy to be here to share this beautiful 20 minutes of love, connection, and continuing the liberation, you know, mission of ensuring that we could use this art forms just as hip hop culture to not only reconnect, but also be a part of the front line that changes the narrative. I represent Uganda proudly as a founder of Mavubuka Foundation, but I wanted to take you directly to the engine of what has allowed us to really reimagine and re-envision how we can use hip-hop culture as a tool to bring our people together, starting with the young ones, it being a youthful platform of engagement and learning and knowledge. In my space of the years I've spent working with Indigenous communities, which is like around a good 17 years now, it's been a struggle to, you know, build a beautiful, accessible platform that is supported by the community due to the conditioning that hip hop was a violent movement, due to the propaganda of the negativity that had really allowed all the parents, especially on the continent, and I'm sure abroad, to really deter their young ones to participate in hip hop culture. But over time, you know, as Bavubuka Foundation, I took my mandate to say that, you know, we'll find unconventional methods to reconnect, heal, restore, awaken, unify, and transform our community through the hearts of the youth. I started investing in young people around East Africa where no one wanted to invest in young people. So I would travel to villages, I would create mini gatherings. We would sit under mango trees and be able to have a cup of tea and eat some cassava and politic about issues that were pertaining to our current realities and the futures we imagined. That gave me an opportunity to really think about, you know, how we can indeed find opportunities within a cultural space and adopt the narrative of, you know, hip hop, you know, being that the blueprint is on the continent and it's in all Indigenous communities, that how do we center these young people to identify with the memory that was before, that our relatives in the diaspora were able to reconnect to their DNA and translate back to us. So now we could engage with it and also reconnect deeply to where we're from. Of course, I'm a child of the diaspora too. I left Uganda when I was 12. And then I had the opportunity of growing up in this beautiful Americas and Canada, you know, learning so much. So I was in the thick of the culture and learning really what it meant. But usually for me, what stood out is the idea that when we talked about hip hop, Africans thought it was an American thing and it was distant from them. You know what I'm saying? There was no narrative to literally be that, oh, it's actually centered in our ancestral, you know, DNA, that our brothers were able to reconnect and channel this memory and rebirth it back for us to tap in, so the stool could now play its role to liberate all of us across the globe. And today, as we speak, there's a lot of Indigenous communities that are utilizing hip hop, not only as a tool to teach, but also as a tool to preserve, archive, and be able to keep their heritages alive, you know? And so within the hip hop sphere, what we're focused on is looking at what drives us literally from a humanist perspective, you know, before we look at the context of just being, you know, Indigenous from the continent. And for us to be able to draw that for young people, we had to look at their dreams. You know, can they imagine that they could dream, and what do their dreams look like? We had to understand, do they understand what vision is? Do they envision things? And we looked at their capacity and talents as creative beings. And so when I understood that, we had to kind of like pay attention to those, you know, dreams, visions, creativity, and guidance, I went into the idea of, like, okay, well, we all could do our self-discovery together. So my deciding to go back to Uganda to engage with the Indigenous hip hop narrative came from me wanting to self-discover and reconnect. And when I got there, I moved on to finding challenges, you know, which was the mindset of my people, the kind of education that was there, the lack of resources, you know, that was unavailable, and the lack of space, you know. And I understood that with those challenges being prevalent in the country, even if we had, you know, to sit under a mango tree, as long as we are convening and knowing that we are contributing to our progressive achievements forward, that we could be able to take those actions. Fast forward the clock 15 years later, with this information being spread in different villages, towns, and cities, we are able to see our young people now lead, guide, become educators, become teachers. And clearly, a lot of the young people that have gone through the Bavubuka space, they understand that the actual practice within is to promote health, to promote love, create awareness, and spread the wealth. And we believe that, you know, by doing that, we can be able to strongly bring our people together and take responsibility to change and be self-reliant. Can you hear me? Someone came through and I got this.
Yes, hello? We can hear you. Apologies for that disruption. You can continue, Molly.
Okay. And so we understood by, you know, accessing young people to this kind of knowledge and wisdom, where they understand what health in their community is and love and awareness and wealth, what that truly represents, could position them as great leaders and contributors to changing the narrative and in hindsight, reclaiming the communities they come from. When we say to be an Indigenous MC, and I'll move through a bunch of the slides because I present using it a lot, but I'll go through due to limitation of time. When we talk about hip hop from an Indigenous framework, we mean that an MC or a practitioner in the hip hop space, they're one with the land, they're one with their people, and they love themselves, and that they use hip hop as a tool of empowerment and as a tool for the community. They also use hip hop as a tool of liberation and not just as a tool of consumerism and oppression. So when we're able to share this with these young people, we're able to also communicate in different ways that they can see themselves contributing to all of this connection point. Am I one with the land? That means, am I actually focused on growing my own food? You know, am I being able to preserve and cultivate, to share and build, and also create wealth for myself? When we talk about one with the people, you know, having to gather and convene and engage with the wisdoms of the elders. You know, when you talk about self-love, is do I have room and space to express my ideas, my visions, and what I, you know, and what I connect to? And so I think that, you know, over time I've seen that today when we talk about hip hop culture in Uganda, we don't have a lot of popular rappers or MC, but we have a lot of leaders who have influenced the landscape around East Africa by starting movements versus than just creating artists. So probably we have more hip hop movements in our sphere than a lot of regions because we're focused on cultural best identity and pushing all the movements that were connected to hip hop culture as a platform to express and connect to resources. This, once again, you know, it ties into the idea of, like, when you say you're an Indigenous MC, where is your root core inspiration as an Indigenous MC lie, you know, relies? You know what I mean? Where do you stem yourself to stand and say, I identify myself? We know that as orators, that it's the language, it's the expression. So growing up in Canada, I was losing my language. And being able to go home, I was also given an opportunity to reconnect to narratives that would never exist in the English sphere. So that also showed me the importance of being able to focus on language as a paramount contributor. Matter of fact, the essence of an Indigenous MC is definitely tied to the language piece, because this is the root of our authentic cultural expression. It's the power of the freedom to connect and create. It's the ultimate guide to our self-identity, and it's the key communicator of our understanding. And I know that there's a quote from the late Madiba that says, when you speak to a man in a foreign language, it goes to his mind. But when you speak to him, to his Indigenous language, it goes to the heart. I think it was such narratives for me that inspired me to understand that there was a need to emphasize the preservation of our language, the preservation of our Indigenous dialects, and ensure that through hip hop culture, we could make them colorful, fun, and cool for young people to engage in. Our movement as artists in Uganda is known for preserving languages and being the first Indigenous hip hop pioneers. Why? Because we knew that as if we emulated the West, we would be definitely not accepted in our own communities, because they would have to translate the understanding of what we're talking about, and which was the mostly praised artists at that time were artists that could rap in English. So we had to literally fight the media, fight all the houses that regulated the dissemination of information to validate our expression on all their platforms. It probably took us like a good 12 years, but we were really committed to ensure that space and room for Indigenous practitioners is availed. And so today, as Bavubuka Foundation and as the Back to the Source movement, we focus on really a few things that we think drive the community to tap into its liberation space. And that's, who are the mentors? Like, you called us Mualimus here. It's important for the community to have its Mualimus who are willing to share the information in all levels and capacity that it could be accessed. Because one of the things that's keeping our people backwards is actually the information, access to sharing, access to connecting. So we started to frame language and giving it our own power. Like, when we say we need a mentor, we're looking at someone who's willing to share wisdom, knowledge, and willing to introduce platforms for growth that challenge and support our generation of builders to grow. And then we have our beautiful youthful energy. We call them the catalysts. These are the dedicated young leaders who exhibit the ability to quickly cause change or action. Anyone who's worked with young people know that the minute you spark their light, they will go lightheads, you know, lightheaded ahead of you and be able to show you new ways and new things to accomplish things. But also the most powerful trait that we wanted to create is what we'll call the builders. Now, you've heard of the stone that the builder refused will always be the head cornerstone. I like to say that, you know, being able to play that music and tune into it, I got to understand that the stories of being marginalized that we tell are represented in this narrative that we are destined to be head cornerstones, but we're not affirming that daily. So in Uganda and in our space, we created a movement of builders. And we define the builders as leaders who are dedicated to facilitating, organizing, and mobilizing transformative educational spaces for their communities. This gives a lot of young creative artists a powerful platform to engage, you know, whether they were MCs, they were, you know, academic, whether they were lawyers, whether they were farmers. It opened up to a space of saying, I'm a builder, and they knew what they're building was for. And at the same time, they treated themselves as a brick to be a part of a bigger foundation that could be laid to liberate the community. And when we talk about builders, once again, I would like to give you a definition in the context in which, you know, we utilize this word. So to be builders in the context of Indigenous hip hop practice, a builder is defined as an individual whose vision, aspirations, and ideas are passionately driven to lead, innovate, and engineer creative solutions which contribute to self-liberation and service for humanity. This is what we call the awakening of our youth to become architects for community design. We believe that all creative leaders and builders are architects for community design. When you're able to show a young person the power of their gift to be able to impact change, they quickly become engaged and they become students who definitely want to go through the process and attain or achieve what they've been able to envision. We do this by understanding that when we talk about liberation, we also have to be connected to liberating education, not just education, but liberating education. For we understand that most of the education that our young people have been given has been chaining them down and not giving them the framework to become masters of their own destiny, which in hip hop space, you know, to be a hip hop, you know, enthusiast or practitioner, it means that you're a master of your own strategy. So you take your creativity and apply it to be able to not only take care of self, but the community outwardly. And so these things for us as Indigenous practitioners within this narrative have guided us to know that we are a part of reframing and redesigning the hip hop narrative so that when our relatives from the diaspora come to visit us, we have also done the work to be able to share various frameworks that participate in contributing to what they were able to channel and, you know, and re-manifest again. But that also being said, there's the part where we've also emphasized a holistic approach to everything we do. So it's never about just poetry, just rapping, or just fashion, or just journalism. It's a community that's together. It's a community that's whole. So it doesn't matter what the practice is, we encourage a lot of these young people to bring their practices, and we'll find a way forward together. And as you know, building solutions from within. And when we talk about that, we've seen a lot of young people also now move in powerful spaces to raise the frequency of hip hop to be influential. In this slide, you can see Brother Hustler J from Mombasa, and you can see the young brother Wete, youth leader for the Vubuka Foundation, with the U.S. ambassador. And my other brother is with the Chief Justice of Kenya. And these are all hip hop practitioners whose work in the community has moved them forward now to show the impact that they are contributors. So it takes away the narrative of young people being time wasters and being discarded to inviting them to be in spaces that matter to contribute to the voice that pushes them forward. The other thing I wanted to talk about is this word identity, something that hip hop culture has allowed us to base our foundation on. When you're in hip hop, they talk about originality. So as an MC, to be authentic, you have to know where you're coming from and what you stand on. So searching within your spirit holistically, feel the essence of freedom, guiding your mind, body, and soul, acknowledging your journey to decolonize your mind, to fully tune into your source of life, which is the power of the creative God within you. We're talking about the arts and its impact, which they do say that art imitates life. And if God created this life that we are living, then of course you got to understand that there's a power, reflection, active energy that's godly within you. And I strongly believe that that's what has allowed us to say that when we come from marginalized communities, we could go over and beyond and take over the world. And remember that we are indeed chosen souls and individuals who've been put here to manifest something that's greater. So most of us who talk about, oh, you know, I came from a background that was, you know, that was marginalized. I came from, you know, the ghetto, and now I'm, you know, I've made it, you know. These narratives are in the essence of self-identifying and being able to adhere to the message in which we choose to reconnect. When we started the leadership retreat back to the source as part of our programming, it gave us the power to know that we can now be able to identify the dedicated leaders who tap into this energy and have become not only participants, but driving forces of the message that is teaching other communities how to center themselves around holistic learning and coming together to find to reimagine the futures that they want to design together. And our job was to always come in and take actions with them to achieve that. So I think that within the hip hop sphere space, it's been beautiful to see that most of our young people now on the continent, those who have connected to hip hop culture from an identified space, take a different route versus than the pop culture route to participate in justice and liberation for our people. And that's, I think, one of the powerful achievements that this platform is able to, you know, render us. And I want to talk about hip hop and spirituality, because without the hip hop spirituality, we would not honor the power of reconnection. So the brother, ancestor, the Honorable Marcus Garvey, he said that repatriation is a must. And when he said that repatriation is a must, a lot of people were not able to tap into what that idea and vision at the time meant. And so because many did not listen, just like we had failed to listen prior to these actions that we're taking now, it kept a lot of our relatives behind and back. The message of reconnecting to the continent has been here from jump. Just like it said, you know, we must take our people back to the continent. You know, so we also engage in a place called reconnection is a must. When we say reconnection is a must, we feel like if they did not repatriate, we must now carry the message of being able to awaken the spirit of reconnection so that they can find a way to reconnect to something and information. You know, not everyone would travel to Africa. We do understand that. But the power to be on your journey to seek information, source your direction, moving towards your own reconnection, regaining memory. These are all important factors that I feel in our practice we promote a lot when we are teaching indigenous hip hop practices. You know, so spirituality, you know, I don't know if everybody knows, but the acronym of hip hop from one of my mentors, from Mr. Server, from the hip hop metaphysics practice, he said that, you know, when we talk about hip hop, we mean that we're helping individual people help other people. And that's primarily the practice of our daily outreach of being able to connect to each other to make sure that everyone is well. But within that practice, there's also a spiritual existence that moves us. And that is the higher infinite power healing our people. Every time we are able to show these young people these acronyms, they become very interested in exploring different ways to feel like they've deepened their understanding, feel like their music is meaningful, and that they're representing something. I believe that when Africa starts to encounter the narrative of hip-hop from an indigenous perspective, it will highly contribute to a powerful liberating movement on the continent that represents peace, love, unity, and simply having fun. You know, and so as a youth leader within that space, we know that, you know, most of the things that inspire us are the wisdom that we get from the elder. Like, of course, I get a chance to hang out with Elder Baba Buntu, who's come to Uganda around maybe, you know, 5 to 7 years in a row. And has always touched me to bring this hip hop community. And he engages with poets, with writers, with filmmakers. And we get a chance to dip in our contribution to the continent. I feel like what indigenous hip hop culture is allowing us to do is to dip in our practices, whether we are breakers, we are b-boys, we are DJs, we are dancers, we are journalists, or we are farmers. It brings us the essence that allows us to now regain our sphere as liberated, you know, both mentally and spiritually within the spaces that we are operating in. Because most of these young, like we, I think when I think about the indigenous hip hop farmers in Uganda, they've been able to move back to the land. And now, you know, stage versus the land, it's like they'd rather see crops growing. You know, they enjoy engaging with that relationship. But prior, being a farmer was something I was looked down upon. And so I feel like there's so many processes that we're going through by utilizing hip hop culture to decolonize and indigenize the narrative and really create new accesses that give us the information by tapping into our elders of what was here before. Because we might not know it all, but by attuning ourselves to be students with the elders, we'll continue to explore new ways and also innovate, you know, new avenues to apply the knowledge that we have. That being said, you know, I can't, you know, I'll frame my narrative to close up with this. We have what we call the cipher. The cipher is a sanctuary of your truest hip-hop spiritual expression, where you explore your infinite healing energy for self-transformation. Now, we know that when I'm self-transformed, I'm able to convey the feeling of transformation, or someone could be able to witness that I'm transformed and they're interested in my energy to also be able to tap in. So that is one of the most powerful tools that we use village to village, ghetto to ghetto, city to city, is host a series of ciphers. We'll call them gratitude ciphers. And these ciphers are designed to break the marginalized ideologies, the stereotypes of hip-hop culture, and bring hip-hop directly to the children, to the parents, and the grandparents, by all of them witnessing the affirmations that are being presented by the MCs in their unique and authentic practices. And so as an indigenous hip-hop practitioner, my job continues to be able to see that we make the impact, you know, by choosing to follow that energy, you know, that translates, you know, from our colonized minds back to the indigenous spirit, you know, to ensure that we get our young leaders more training to equip themselves with the tools necessary to keep the community moving and to build for generations to come, to create connections, you know, globally with our relatives in the diaspora, continue to creating learning spaces where these bridges bring us together to evolve each other forward. You know, powerful conversations, you know, and engagement, you know, that give us the opportunity to know that we are indeed not static, but we are in motion and the movements are growing. Community needs assessment. We always got to be finding a point where we are creating solutions that are making the lives of our people better. Of course, you know, community service activation, you know, our businesses must, you know, reflect the communities we come from. So our services must be activated to be for our people. And of course, our community elders and youth celebration. When we celebrate our elders and we celebrate our young people, we are at the preservation of our biggest libraries and the new futures that we want to create. And with that being rendered, I'm blessed to be here sharing this information and tapping in with you guys to be able to continue. The journey continues wherever we are. And so as practitioners, we continue to evolve our knowledge and add new and old and whatever will come, you know, to what we're doing. But thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, my brother. You really ignited something fundamental in us. You know, there's so many bars you've dropped using the language of the culture. And I couldn't help but see that you have a striking resemblance of Mutabaruka. So yeah, it's one of the greatest poets and lyricists of our time. Black family, let's get into some questions and interactions with our Mwalimu Mawaluku. And thank you, you know, for sharing authentic experiences, you know, at a ground level, you know, and such practical examples that you've shared. And I love also the questions of using indigenous language, you know, that you have raised in your presentation. In the Azanian context, we've had, for example, the movement of Motswako, which was a whole generation of MCs that, you know, were presenting the culture in their own language of Setswana. And then in the Western and Eastern Cape, we had the Spaza, what they call Spaza, which is also MCs using the language of isiXhosa, you know, to present the culture. So there's been, you know, a strong evolution, even as isiZulu language and so on, that are being used now in hip hop, you know, and also strong artistic interpretation in dance, in public art, that are really bringing out the experiences and the essence of Blackness, you know, and highlighting the conditionality of Blackness, whether it is through, you know, graffiti or public art or other art forms, dance forms, you know. There is a major dance festival, Global Dance Supreme in Azania, that also features a number of hip hop dancers. And one of the biggest festivals in the continent is coming on the 7th of October, Back to the City, which is organized by Osmic Minwe. It's got over 100 MCs, about 40 DJs, and also international MCs that perform at that festival. The next one, the 17th edition, will be on the 7th of October in Newtown at the Mary Fitzgerald Square. So, Black family, I'm just laying the foundation for you to engage and ask questions to Mwalimu Babaluku. And one of the things that you started on is raising the infiltration of the culture through propaganda, you know, and trying to vilify, you know, the culture and making it less attractive, particularly for young people, young Africans especially. How can we try to protect, you know, the culture from further infiltration and even from the propaganda that has been spread around, you know, the importance of the culture and the significance? I mean, there are many other positive things that the culture has registered in the evolution since its inception. The stories, for example, of Afrika Bambaataa, you know, through the Zulu nation, that have changed the whole, you know, complexion of gangsterism and other antisocial behavior in New York. And there are many other such examples, including here in Azania. How can we bring forth many of those examples in pushing against, you know, the negative narratives that are being pushed by the popular media.
Should I go?
Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, so in changing the narrative and creating, there's a word I'm going to drop, it's called access. You know, one thing that our people have not been focused on is understanding if they have access, and if they did, what kind of access they had, you know? And so I'm in the space where looking at, you know, what has been setting us back is the lack of strong, powerful neighborhood design that created access for us to have resources that give us the power to know where we stand, what we stand for, and what we are living for. And so being in that space now, it has become very key and important not to only look at the surface of what the problem is, but to really be at the root on how we cure and heal what the problem is. You know, we're realizing that now if we could avail our 5-year-olds and 7-year-olds a new environment to grow in with this information that we are designing, and that becomes their new institution of following a path to reconnection, I think that we will be giving them a powerful standing and jump forward than dealing with what they're getting in the regular, you know, colonized, you know, context of information they're receiving currently. And so creating our own hood news is important, creating our own platforms. Ownership must be at the foundation of what we're doing, because if we're going to talk about legacy for this culture and for this art, we have to own every inch and every bit of what we've created it to propel forward. And so I feel like, you know, giving our people access and creating new keys of this kind of access, whether it's in tech, whether it's in agriculture, whether it's in arts, you know, whether it's in dance, you know, it's important that we're building these new rooted keys that are culturally designed to holistically represent the participants, no matter where they're situated on the globe. So that could bring back a sense of pride among our people and give them the opportunity to directly now represent their value to the universe. Like, you know, when we come from communities where they've not considered us of value, you know, so it also plays against us. So part of this ownership key is to tie and tune into your own value so that when you go in places and spaces, you know your contribution and the value now you bring them back to the arts and any other space that you're engaging in.
Great stuff, my brother. And there is a comment from Sister Noctula who says she loves the point you made about permission to tap into our innermost untamed energies for self and community healing from all that blinds us symbolically and actually. So that's really a profound way of putting it. Black family, if anyone has a question, I see there's a question from Brother Difference. If there's anyone else, please raise your hand and then we'll take your questions before we wrap up. Brother Difference.
Thank you. And thank you to Mwalimu for that great presentation. Mine is a very quick question. So you've touched on the issue of language, which is quite critical. I come from a minority tribe in South Africa, and people that wanna produce music in my language don't have such a big market when compared to the other artists that come from the bigger tribes or artists that create their music in English. What is your advice to such artists that feel like they don't have a big market if they stick to creating music in their own indigenous languages and they feel the need that, you know, in order for them to blow up, they have to change their language, change their message, and et cetera. I feel like it's just too much pressure for some of the artists that come from those parts.
Yes, I'll gladly answer that because that's a problem I had to walk through from when I was 20 all the way up. But what I learned is that the spirit is larger than the market. They must know that. The spirit is larger than the market. The idea to authentically represent you, the universe is always open for you. you're not limited by industry limitations. So you must also understand that if you're going to be an artist putting out your work. I rap in my native language. I performed in LA. I had a big show at the Kennedy Center. You know, one of the first young black hip hop, you know, given an opportunity by invitation to showcase at the Kennedy, my night, you know, chandeliers big, you know. And so I was rapping in my language even then. Why? Because I tell you, if I was rapping in English, there was too many American rappers that could not, you know what I mean, allow me to have the opportunity as such. But because I choose to attune to the spirit, and then the energy of the spirit can be translated, because now what I'm talking about is not a mere, you know, a song of just, you know, usually you know what pop culture does. People water down their content. So any indigenous MC, you could be remote as you are, as long as you honor your ancestors and you administer to preserve their language and their culture within your creative being, because the gift you're given is to usher that forward. No matter where you go in the universe, there's a stage and platform for you. That message must reach them, because they are not limited. They are only limited because they are looking at a limited industry that limits everything. You know, but on the universal alignment, they are free to move all over the globe, sharing the truth and the stories of their ancestors and tuning into every other indigenous community that's open to receive them. And don't forget, we are still indigenous, so globally we are connected.
Wow, that's truly profound. The spirit is bigger than the market. There's no better way of putting it. Sister Noctula was asking, when you talk about the source, what exactly are you invoking?
Yeah, that's another beautiful one. I had to evolve through it. So what I'm invoking is the idea that mentally, spiritually, you can allow yourself to evolve and be in a conversation of your self-evolution. You know, when you grow up in the West, you stagnate mentally, and your spirit disappears because you're locked within concrete walls that totally block you off of that access. The reason we move towards the continent and feel serene and feel like the sacredness of the land is because it doesn't matter where you drop me on a continent, I can see infinite still, you know, apart from the urban setting structures that are there. So that infinite in the West does not exist. People are living in barricaded concrete walls and can't see further than what they see for years, and they've been walking on a grid. I call that concrete misalignment. You know what I'm saying? It impacts us how we think, how we move, and how we attune to various energies. So being on a continent, for me, part of my tapping back to the source is reclaiming my ancestral assignment. You know, the more I journey to honor, because I'm not the first one here, it's my belief. I'm a representation of fulfilling some of the works that they were trying to fulfill. And I feel like every time I tune into that conversation, it's when the bigger things happen for me. It's when the doors open effortlessly. So I've learned to respect and honor that. So journeying for the truth in you and reconnecting to your ancestral assignment is what I would term my back to the source connection is. For Uganda, we literally every year do a retreat called Back to the Source. And we guide ourselves to the source of the Nile. And the framework there is to dare imagine if we had ancestors that grew up with our civilization and we are a representation of them. What does that mean for us now who are still here to represent something greater? So I feel like back to the source, when you choose to navigate towards your source, is the only way you could tap into your greatness. And so we're encouraging that narrative to also be seated in the hearts of the young ones.
Wow, that's too beautiful. Thank you very much, Mwalumi. Sister Noctula says she feels like ululating deeply and unashamedly. So she's quite excited with the response that you have given. And you're quite right that sometimes there are all these impediments that are placed before us that prevent us from attuning spiritually, and we see them as aesthetically pleasing, but the, you know, resultant impact of those high walls, you know, is really to disconnect us spiritually. And I love what you said about reclaiming our ancestral mission, and I think that's a good way to leave this discussion, to, you know, nudge everybody to pursue their ancestral mission, to understand what it is, and to ensure that it is fulfilled, at least within their lifetime. Thank you very much, Mwalimu. And I also want to thank a lot to our sister, Wema Rahopala, you know, and take away what she says, that fear paralyzes and courage mobilizes. So let us not be fearful of claiming our ancestral mission, but let us have the courage to mobilize each other towards the greater goal of truly liberating Africa, not just physically, but also spiritually. Thank you very much, Black Family, for joining this masterclass. We are grateful for your participation and contribution, and we trust that you have been truly enriched by this experience. I certainly have been, and our speakers have really, you know, raised the bar in terms of the presentations that have made, and really using, you know, the arts, but actually more than just the arts, culture as a navigational instrument towards our essence of being. Thank you very much. This is the end of the masterclass for today. And we trust that you will have a great evening further on. Thank you, Mwalimu, and thank you to Sister Wema as well.
Arambe.
Arambe. Arambe.
Arambe.
Arambe.
Arambe.
Arambe.
Obulamu tulina sagala mukabe ufubetu kolele wambu embele tujichuse obulamu tulina sagala mukabe ufubetu kolele wambu embele tujichuse.
I'm an Africa, no matter where I go, I got to let them know I represent where I'm from. I'm an Africa, the land of the original man, it's black and beautiful, I love the way I'm from. I'm an Africa, we'll get us this ghetto, but all my ghetto children still smile without a dime. I'm an Africa, I let my ancestors' presence be felt when I scream all power to the people. I represent one out of many that met it, so when I said it, understand it's for my people, so get it. The Zion train, I can see it coming, brothers traveling across the border, revolution. Second over city to city, from ghetto to ghetto, the spirit of music banging like metal. We call it heavy ghetto rebel music, speaking for our people, telling you stories that have never been told. Our kids who grow up in poor strife, praying for Uhuru. Better tomorrow by ending in sorrow. Inspired by the spirit of my ancestors, I'm ready to struggle. My ghetto cool, like commuting like invisible kids. Until this rebel's get God, I got a reason to speak. I'm an Africa, no matter where I go, I got to let them know I represent where I'm from. I'm an Africa, the land of the original man, it's black and beautiful, I love the way I'm from. I'm an Africa, we'll get us this ghetto, but all my ghetto children still smile without a dime. I'm an Africa, I let my ancestors' presence be felt when I scream all power to the people.
I spit it for the love of it, it's mad dip in its face. My crew in the ghetto, we're decking over playing for gifts. Black Panther, I speak the revolution of free. Soldiers, ghetto heaven, set my vision to see. Invaded by many, so see they gotta try by any means necessary to survive, struggle to stay alive. See, this is where I'm from. You can't have Burundi, Rwanda, Tanzania, Kenya, hear my people screaming back home. It's like a jungle, there's a war going on out here. Executing my shit is ready to slay. But see, nobody cares, so we die in despair. Asking God, like, my life ought to be so hard. But my people still wonder why it's still unfair. I guess my reason for this black revolution is clear. Africa, no matter where I go, I got to let them know I represent where I'm from. I'm an Africa, the land of the original man, it's black and beautiful, I love the way I'm from. I'm an Africa, we'll get us this ghetto, but all my ghetto children still smile without a dime. I'm an Africa, I let my ancestors' presence be felt when I scream all power to the people.
We ain't stopping with this rebel music, spit the liberation. Making the dollar, I'm set up for my generation. Bubble book at the foundation. Ready to take their beef across town and scared of confrontation. Freedom fighters, music, screaming powers to the people. From Brooklyn, New York, it echoes down in Soweto like Africa, Africa, Africa. Rise, time to reach for your prize. We break loose out of the ghetto, the city streets for revolution. Bangkok, my people say we want peace.
Freedom is coming tomorrow.
Ready to get them, my brother, we gotta go.
The Zion train is coming, gotta get ready
for this.
Exodus.
For I belong to a higher power, moving.